Iguodala to Curry, back to Iguodala, up for the layup. Oh, blocked by James. LeBron James with the rejection.
Wow. Because this is a career-long attempt for Tyler Durbin, who's super reliable inside of 40. This is from 45, and it's blocked. Lions scoop it up.
They'll give it to Singleton to the 15, 20, Singleton 25, 30. He's to the 40, he's to the 50. Goodbye, he is gone. Nicholas Singleton to the house. 87 yards.
Pickett.
Cannot be stopped.
It's Zach.
And Prawn. That's the name.
It's the Zap Show right now.
It's the Zap Show. Zach Prime. I'm coming at you from a hotel in New Jersey. We got some business to take care of. But
what's that business, show goes Zach? On.
I don't want to say yet. I don't want to say yet.
You got the iPhone though.
Yeah. It's some good business. It could be good business. I don't want to I don't believe in like jinxing or anything like that.
Yeah. But
I just don't want to like put my, what's the saying? Like put my car in front of my horse. Like I just want to stay I think that's the saying. I just don't want to get too ahead of myself. I just don't want to get too ahead of myself and stay level and, you know, whatever happens, happens.
Yeah.
Definitely also, the tuner in as we'll know, but
that's awesome. That's awesome, dude. But was it back-to-back shows on Thursday? We got a iPhone recording. Let's go.
Yep.
Riverside. Yeah. Duality.
Dude, I'm really getting sick of this life shit, man, because it's always something. It is always something. Like, that's the thing I'm learning as I'm growing up. It is always something. Like, everything could be going smoothly. Like, one part of your life that, you know, has been shitty for a while could finally start to turn around, and then you know, something else happened, like with your car, or like in my instance, the reason I'm on my iPhone is because I may or may not have failed to properly put my cap on my Gatorade and put it in my backpack. And I think the ports to my laptop got fried because it won't charge.
It's tough.
Or turn on.
It's a sticky situation, probably.
Yeah, it wasn't that. It wasn't even like half a Gatorade. It was like a couple sips. I didn't even need to like bring it, but I was like rushing on the bag.
See, that's when you gotta down the hatchet, bro. If it's just a couple sips,
it was like a quarter. It was like a quarter. Okay. I don't even know why I brought it.
You don't have the side pocket on the backpack, man.
No, I trust me. I was sitting and thinking to myself, like, why the hell don't I have a side pocket in my backpack?
Yeah, dude, like that. That's like. Well, that's that Swiss brand, bro. Like, that's what you need.
Yeah.
I got the dual, bro. Always had that thing strapped
in. You do have that. Because I'd see it at the Onward State meetings. Mm-hmm. You got the Onward
shirt. Always got that water on me, bro. Guzzle.
I do too, but I had it in my, like, in the sack. Like, in the big, like, sack.
I just think it's I said it before. I think it's crazy that you're still drinking Gatorade, though. I think I would have protested Gatorade a little bit.
I mean, I don't want to say it's an addiction, but like sometimes I just need a little bit more than water. And it's not my diet. It's not Diet Coke either.
That's
Diet Coke. That might be an addiction, but not as much as some people. Dude, before we get into the show, that's actually a good segue into a little personal anecdote. I sent you a picture earlier of Mr. Charles Barkley, who I ran into the other day. I got to, well, my girlfriend works with CNN Underscored. She does like product advertising marketing for them. And it's CNN, so she gets some inside passes to go to these like shows and stuff. Like sometimes it'll be like Anderson Cooper or like special events, like for game releases and stuff like that. So like product releases, fun stuff. This time it happened to be CNN happened to be, Charles Barkley has a special with Gail King on there called King Charles. And it's like, it's a CNN, like CNN thing. Like they produce it. So he was in the studio and she could bring a guest. So she signed up and she's like, hey, you want to go? I was there. So I was like, hell yeah. Like I'm going to see Charles Barkley up close and personal. That was sick. So yeah, I got to see Chuck like do a show. It was a fun show. It wasn't sports. It was more like entertainment, a little bit of politics. But he's good, man. He's funny. Like he's good old Chuck, same inside the NBA Chuck. And one of my like favorite things I always remember is Gail asked him about his like New Year's resolution. He's like, oh man, he's like, well, I got a bad relationship with my Diet Coke. Might have an addiction to Diet Coke. She's like, Chuck, how many do you drink like normally? He's like 12 to 14 like a day.
Oh man,
I know. And she's like, so how much do you have today? He's like, 8. Just before he went on.
God.
I was like, damn, I thought I was bad. I maybe have like six a week, maybe. I won't even say one a day. But yeah, and then so he came, he knew somebody in the audience, so he came over at the end and obviously, people started taking advantage, taking pictures. I snapped one with him, my girlfriend and I. And I was like, hey, Chuck, like, he's like, I feel you on that Diet Coke thing. Or like, don't feel bad. Cause like, I'm like in the same boat. I'm the same way. And he like laughed. So I thought that was funny.
Hell yeah. And
yeah. I got a picture with him. So.
Dude, you gotta be like, next time you get in a situation where you think you might see Charles Barkley, you gotta have like a mini case of Diet Coke for him.
Dude, fact. He said he's trying to kick it, though. I feel like he'd be like, nah, get this man out of here. Oh,
shit. Yeah, I didn't know you were trying to kick it. I didn't know you were trying to kick it. Damn.
Well, he said that, but it's like, it is hard. It's hard to kick, man. It's just something about it. Something about it with meat. It's like, I need, every time I eat meat, like, I need a Diet Coke.
I don't, like, I think I'm maybe proud to say this, seeing how, like, people get addicted to it. I've never had a sip of Diet Coke in my life.
Respect, but you could or be
like
out.
Maybe if I did, maybe if I did. Oh no, like Dr. Pepper used to drink like 4 cans a day. Was on the Coke, like. But my biggest vice was Turkey Hill iced tea. It kind of still is. Like I still need like a cup of it every now and then. Like maybe like a cup a day. I didn't have a cup today, but like I used to be like a quart. Like at least a day, never got to a gallon, but like it got to the point where I was like, dude, Toby, you're gonna get like a kidney stone, something's gonna be bad. So that's why
shit's
I'm always
good, though, man.
It's so good, but that's why I'm so conscientious of like knocking these down, because I just feel like my body like suffered a lot of iced tea trauma. Like I need years of water to get this thing.
I at least you know you recognized and you're on the come up now.
I still need another cup though, but my mom's smart. She like bought the quarts instead of the gallon, and like that makes me feel better because I can see like even if it's one cup, it looks like I drank so much of it. I'm like, oh, that's way too much. So now I'm pouring myself like half cups. Like it's I got like a nice little kind of cut away from it.
This is such a mom suggestion, but you could like water it down. I hate doing that, but you could water it down.
Dude, that's the thing, because you can add ice to it.
Yeah, ice.
But like, I've never been an ice guy. I've always been a pure, really? And like, I'm a little gross with it too. I can't even marinate this out, but like, sometimes like at work, especially, I'll pour a cup and then like sit it like in a corner and almost wait for it to warm up. Just warm just a little bit. Like, don't be cold, but warm a little bit. That's like the best ice. Oh, I'll chug it. Like, it's so good. There's some
like room temp. Like
a little bit colder than that, but like not like fresh out of the fridge cold. Like probably like sits for like 20 minutes, 15, 20 minutes.
I feel that. That's not that bad. Yeah. But hey, man, it is. It's episode 33. Like it's time our tuner. It's time we let our tuner in or in a little bit.
Yeah, dude. I mean, yeah. If you're sticking around, like, might as well learn about us. But Jesus, 33. Scottie Pippen.
Yeah. Damn. Pippen, baby. There is my favorite number. That was my football number.
33.
Been my favorite number ever since.
Yeah, you were in the secondary. Yeah, you were definitely in the secondary with 33.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no fly zone.
That was my shit.
No fly zone. Hell yeah.
My favorite number to this day. Hopefully, it's one of our best episodes yet. I mean, I'm on a phone. Excuse me. In a hotel. But, you know.
The show goes on.
The show goes on. Lupe Fiasco, baby. The
show goes on. But yeah, we should just dive right in the get into
Let's
the sports.
It.
Let's get into
Let's
the sports.
Let's do it, baby.
Obviously, NFL playoffs, yeah. I do want to touch NFL news, though, very quickly. Basically, coaching news. Belichick looks like – well, actually, yeah, Belichick. We'll start with Belichick. Looks like he's going to be with Atlanta Falcons pending a second interview. That's what Shefty said. Interesting. I mean, Kyle Pitts, Bijan, Drake London are celebrating right now. They're so hyped. And there's no – like, I just feel like this is – there's going to be a Justin Fields trade to Atlanta because there's no way if Belichick takes over, he's going to want Ritter as his quarterback.
No chance.
He's definitely going to – Belichick definitely is going to have to figure out a quarterback plan. I think that's probably what the second interview maybe is going to be about. I don't know. Figuring out, all right, if I do come, this is what I want. So we'll see there. Another coach who interviewed with the Falcons, but I never saw this happening, Jim Harbaugh. Interview with the Falcons, also interview with the Chargers. That one seems more likely. Although, I don't know. Did you see Harbaugh say in his contract negotiation with Michigan that he doesn't, like in a clause, he doesn't want to get fired if anything happens due to NCAA investigations?
I did not see that, but makes sense.
He had it in his... For that reason, and for like basically, I want to coach here until I retire, was basically sort of the contract that he wanted. Which he won a championship, like brought back Michigan. That's fair. I mean, I don't know.
I'm thinking he looks at his brother and is kind of like, because I feel like John Harbaugh, maybe not, he's young, he might go somewhere else, but I don't know. But I feel like he looks at what his brother has and the kind of just the, you know, Ravens have been relevant since he took over. So,
yeah.
Maybe he looks at what his brother has and he's kind of like, I want that.
Dude, I mean, you kind of think about it this way. Mike Tomlin, 17 consecutive seasons. John is 16 with the Ravens.
Damn.
Like, yeah, it's one less season. If you think about it like that way, when like we praise Tomlin, John's been there just as long, like 1 year shorter. Exactly. So we'll see there. But maybe he wants to hop back in the NFL game. I don't know. Definitely developing there. But remaining in college, Cliff Kingsbury, which you didn't know, he got interviewed for the Chicago Bears OC position. For living under a rock, that's USC coaches Caleb Williams right now, who's number one pick, and that's who Chicago has. That's why it's a pretty big deal. kind of alluding to Chicago maybe going after Williams and trading Justin Fields. Kind of what it sounds like, but he hasn't been hired yet, just interviewed. So, never know.
Juicy, man. That's juicy right there.
But that's exactly what it would be like. So then you got to think Justin Fields is going to get traded, and like, what destinations would you see him at? I mean, Atlanta, New England. I'm just trying to think of any other, what other teams would be looking. I mean, I'm going to say Steelers, but I don't think Steelers would do that. I mean, as much as I would love it, I don't think they would.
No, thank.
There's also, there's a lot of quarterbacks on the free agent market, so it's also tough to ask that question because a lot of people have to get signed or whatever. But I will say that's a pretty big domino to fall first of finding out in the offseason where Justin Fields go. Because that's definitely going to be before the draft. So it's going to be happening before free agency and all that. So that'll be interesting.
Yeah, but Caleb declaring and Cliff with that interview is like happening. We talk about domino effect, like that happening like days with apart from each other. Like, I don't know, man.
And like,
I don't know.
You think that would translate? I mean, like, that's a pretty damn smart play by the Chicago Bears.
I think Cliff's problem was like never his mind. I think it was just like his, like, he couldn't lead a team. Like, he couldn't lead a team, but you know, he can call play. I think he can call plays. Definitely. If he's the OC, I think he can absolutely call plays. You know, take a lesser role and just strictly focus on that.
So does Chicago have another pick besides, I should know this, but besides the number one? I think they do. In the first round. Yeah, number nine.
It's nine.
I'm just trying to think, like, do you, like, load up Caleb then? Add another receiver there at nine? I don't know. There's a lot, dude. That's like, dude. I don't know. That's, everybody, like, wants to be a GM until, like, think about this scenario, like, right now. Like, this is a tough scenario, I feel like, for Chicago Bears right now. It is. Make or break job season for them.
It is. But also, like, shoot, do you go down, like, right now it's like, do you go down with the ship? Or do you, I mean, shoot, Caleb Williams he's one of the best quarterback prospects that we've had. It's like, do you go down with the ship or do you turn it in for a shiny new one? I don't know.
Dude, I mean, personally, I think you don't go down with the ship. I think Justin Fields would thrive in a new situation. And even with Chicago, I think he's good. I just think he needs better help on the line and just calling plays or whatnot. But Chicago Bears, they have to go for Caleb Williams, man. Especially, like, I just, you get Cliff there too. It just seems like it makes the most sense.
Do they keep both and, like, have a quarterback competition sort of thing?
But, like,
and then trade Justin?
But, like, why would you keep both when you could get Marvin Harrison and have DJ Moore and Justin Fields?
They'd have to trade up for Marvin, probably.
The Bears would have number one. So why would you? That's what I'm saying. Like, why?
You're gonna
pick Caleb Williams and have a quarterback battle. I feel like that just makes. That doesn't make much sense.
It doesn't. No, I was just pitching
spitballing there. Hey, appreciate the different perspectives.
Yeah. Dude, Justin, Marvin. I mean, DJ Moore seems to love Justin Fields. I mean,
yeah, that's what I'm saying.
So
I think what we learn a little bit about as we more go on is that sometimes like the players aren't heard enough. And like I saw it a lot with the Steelers, and I feel like it's a lot with the Chicago Bears right now, where like the media keeps on saying that like Justin's lost, that he's not there, like whatever, trying to like force his way out. When I feel like the players like love Fields. They would run through a brick wall for Justin Fields. Media and all that stuff, locals just kind of tearing it down, fans and all that. I don't know, but that could just be me.
Yeah, I mean,
I feel like they all ride with him.
Yeah, it seems like, I mean, when your number one weapon does, I mean, DJ Moore is, I mean, they had a couple backs come on at the end of the year, but yeah, jeez, it is a tough situation. It is a tough situation, but it could be like a win-win situation, or it could be a lose-lose.
Like, yeah.
You don't know.
But yeah, that's all I had there. Steelers, though, do want to touch on this a little bit, and I'll make this short. Tomlin had his, like, exit, end of season sort of interview. Like, one of my favorite, if not the favorite, Mike Tomlin, like, press conference I've ever watched. So candid. So Mike Tomlin. Like, I just, if you want to see, like, who Mike Tomlin is, go watch that. It's so beautiful. But, said all the right things today. Everything that I wanted to hear, he said it, and he meant it. Started out by joking about him walking off on the contract question, but said he's staying. Never said he was going to take a break from coaching. In fact, Rooney came on after Tomlin and said we're going to extend him, which makes me feel better about what he also stated, that they're looking for an outside offensive coordinator. Thank you. Not Sullivan or whoever is going to get promoted. We're going to get an outside guy, which I love. Thank you. I think him, Omar, and Rooney are going to be looking for him, whoever that may be, new OC. Speaking of offense, looking at all quarterback options, I love to hear that. Not giving full keys to Kenny, saying he will be challenged, but saying he has a lot of confidence in him. That's cool. What I would assume, or what I would enjoy, is Kenny, maybe like a veteran quarterback and a rookie, but someone in the draft. But time will tell. But I do like that outside OC and quarterback competition. That's what I want. I don't want to like fully give it to Kenny. Word for it. He reiterated what Najee was saying, which I also said on the show, about how there needs to be structure changes, kind of in-house stuff, which I love that. He said those are coming. And that was basically all the highlights I had of everything that he said. Loved every little bit of it. He had a couple tidbits. I don't know. Marquise Pouncey's my man. He said one of his biggest regrets in his career is not making him world champion. That hit home to me because I wish we would have won one with him and Killer B's era. But, hey, man, it's hard to win a Super Bowl in the NFL.
You said it. That's why I feel the same sort of sentiment about Kelsey. Just glad, so glad he got one. At least he can, you know, hang his head high on that.
Yeah.
But yeah, I you don't like, you don't think Mitch is that veteran guy for
Kelsey? No. I would like, I've been hearing a lot of Jacoby Brissett, which I would be like okay with, because I know he could come in and at least like in a Mitch role, like, play better. In all reality, it's like probably gonna be like Mason, Kenny, and like, I don't know, like, watch it be like Trace McSorley or some shit. Be like, god damn it, like, our veteran is, or whatever.
Is he on the practice squad or
not anymore? We caught him.
He's fully caught, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we caught him before the playoffs, so feel bad because like I would have liked to maybe see him, but at the same time, like, I don't know, like, Mason was playing good, and even if Mason got bad, it was gonna be Kenny. It was like, you don't just throw him in there just because I want to see him. But no, I don't, like, I have to look a lot more at like what the options are for offensive coordinator, but I like that we're going somewhere. That's what I think I said way earlier, like in our teenage years on this podcast, was we need to get somebody outside of the 412. I don't want a Yinzer in here. So that's great. And it just seems like, it seems like Mike Tomlin is like, you know, like when the kids act up and like, like the wife or mom is like, hey, you got to, like, talking to the dads, like, hey, you got to step up, like, you got to do something. And the dad's always like, no, they'll figure it out. They're kids, whatever, whatever. And but then they finally did enough fucked up shit where the dad's like finally getting off the couch or whatever, putting his beard down, and he's going to go fucking talk to the kids and he's going to whip them into shape. And those kids are going to be fucking soldiers after that. I think, like, that's what I felt in that post-game press conference. And I'm just confident, man. Like, let's go. Let's ride.
Let's go, man. Yeah, it's, I mean, it, not the end of the season that you want. I mean, but shit, the Bills are a freaking machine right now. So
like, I think like this season went way better than I could have expected. I did say before the season started, I said we're not Super Bowl contenders. Like, don't get me wrong, we're not going to win no Super Bowl, but we're going to surprise a lot of people. I think we're going to be like good because everybody was putting us at the bottom of the AFC North at that point. I think they gave us like 6 or 7 wins. They were protecting Mike Tomlin's first ever losing season. We go 10-7 and we skate into the playoffs. Like, bad luck playing draw to the Bills. I mean, like, one of the hottest teams, and then we have to play one of the coldest games, and weather condition games where the game got postponed, whatever. Like, I'm okay with that in a year that's considered rebuilding. Most NFL teams are rebuilding this time. You had a franchise quarterback retire 2 years ago. You know? So I'm okay. I'm okay with it.
Dude, that's the Tomlin effect. That's the Tomlin effect.
And that's what I'm saying. Like, when I see these Steelers fans that are just like fire, I'm like, you guys are like so fucking spoiled. Like, I understand why Tomlin said that. They're fat and spoiled. They're supposed to be doing this. We're supposed to be. I get it. But like, some of y'all gotta get real. That's why it's like I say it's hard to win a Super Bowl, not because like I'm making an excuse, because it fucking is, bro. It's 32 teams trying to do it, and it's complicated. It's hard. There's injuries. There's contracts. There's trades. There's blah blah blah. Like, shit happens. And you're gonna go 10-7 after losing Big Ben with Mitch Trubisky, Mace Rudolph, Kenny Pickett all playing NFL games. Like, there's gonna be YouTube documentaries about this that my kids are going to be watching, being like, Toby, you had to watch through this? Be like, yeah, it sucked, man.
Hey, you had a couple,
but not really.
You had a couple bright spots.
Yeah, I was saying, it didn't really suck. I just meant like, yeah, like things were like that back in the day, but it was still electric.
Yeah. I feel you on the, fans coming at the head coach. Eagles fans are in the same boat right now, coming at Sirianni. But I think it's a totally, like, different situation. Totally different situation. This is a guy who, and I'll keep this quick before we talk about the playoffs, but because I thought the Eagles were potentially going to fire Sirianni. I don't know if it's going to come now. I don't know if it's going to come. Doug Peterson was fired, like, immediately after the loss to the Seahawks. I think he's going to stay, which I don't like. I would have rather completely new regime, because the entire reason the Eagles suck this year wasn't Sirianni. It wasn't really Hurts. It was a scheme. The scheme was atrocious. Teams caught up to it. It was easy. It was predictable. And that falls on the coordinators. But the thing is, I don't trust Sirianni to make the proper hires coordinator-wise. Like, we're going to end up with freaking, like Brandon Staley and, like, I don't even know. Somebody from the Colts. Like, that's what's going to happen. And I just don't think that moves the needle. I think you got to bring in a guy like Vrabel or Slowick. I don't know about Slowick, but definitely Vrabel, man. Vrabel can fix this mess. The players seem to be like behind Nick, but like they're behind Nick as a person, not Nick as a coach, I think. They say they're behind him as a coach, but like the results don't speak for that. Like if you were behind him as a coach, like something would have changed on the field. Results just don't speak for that. So, to sum it up, I basically feel like shit about the Eagles. And I don't know what direction we're going in. Really don't.
It's just interesting. Every Eagle fan I've talked to besides you has basically been on the same page as far as keep Sirianni and find new OCs and DCs.
Yeah, I think like, I don't think he's going to find – I don't trust him to do that.
But, like, it's not just Sirianni. Like, Howie Roseman is also in those talks.
That's true. But it's guys he's got to mesh with, or you're going to have a freaking, like, Franklin situation where you just, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
I just, like I said, I think it's going to be, like – It's just not. I just don't think it could move the needle, but I could be wrong.
I think like it is such an like this is just me maybe being arrogant. I just feel like it's such an easy problem to solve. Like there could like I don't know. I feel like you just bring in a new mind. You have all the talent on that offense locked up. Like you know what you're getting. Like I don't know, as far as like an offensive coordinator appeal level, like Eagles would be number one because it's like AJ Brown, Devontae Smith, Jalen Hurts. Like, are you kidding me? Like, yes. I mean, Kelsey's gonna blow, but it sounds like Lane's staying and the line kind of will be, you know, same three or four guys there next year. It's like your offense is still good.
Yeah. I feel like
whatever you got last year, throw that in the trash can and never use it again.
But why is Brian Johnson getting head coach interviews with the Cardinals and the Titans? Fucking mind blowing. I don't know what they saw from the Eagles offense this year that was like, that guy. He's the one.
I don't know.
You know what? This ain't that out of pocket, but I think it might be like Rooney Rule related.
Oh,
like yeah, you have to just you know they check the interview box.
Yeah.
The black candidate. That's mine because there's no way that Brian Johnson is getting interviewed for positions.
Yeah, I mean I don't know, but it, like. Also, like, to that notion, though, like, you want Vrabel, but, like, Vrabel's not going to be an offensive coordinator.
Yeah, no, nah, but, like, if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. But, like, I feel like I feel like Frank Reich's going to come back, and it's going to be, like, Brandon Staley, and it's just going to not, I don't know. I could be totally wrong. They could be home run hires, and I could be totally wrong. But, we'll see.
Yeah, for sure. Time will tell. All right. NFL playoffs. Let's just get right into it.
Wasted enough time.
Yeah, I mean, the script wanted it. We're having it. Allen versus Mahomes. I mean, that's probably the biggest game of the weekend by far. 3-3 against each other. Mahomes is 2-0 against Allen in the playoffs. Here's a wild but true fact I saw. This will be Patrick Mahomes' first ever playoff game that is not played at Arrowhead or at a neutral site, a.k.a. the Super Bowl. It's his first away game of the postseason. Did you see that? My lights just turned off. That was a little spooky.
Oh, yeah. Wait, I do notice that now.
Once I started talking about that. So, okay, look, that is just a sign from the heavens that we are locking in on NFL playoffs, but yeah, Patty Mahomes' first ever away game is going to be in Buffalo. They're 3-3 against each other. Allen's going to be looking to knock them off in the playoffs to advance to, I believe this would be the Bills' first conference finals.
This Bills team in since like the decade, at least probably since Jim Kelly.
Definitely first of the Josh Allen era.
Yeah, probably since Jim Kelly.
Tom and Pat.
Probably since Jim Kelly.
Yeah, I mean.
Maybe OJ.
No, they were definitely the 90s. But this is a big one, needless to say. Yeah. I don't know. How are you feeling about this one? I'm up in the air as far as who I think is going to win.
There's one thing I saw that is swaying my opinion 100% because I'm very self-aware. Like I recognize like this is to 100% influencing my opinion on how this game's going to go. But sometimes I feel like these things, you either see them, you like throw them in the trash, or you're like, that's a nugget. Like, that's a nugget right there. Sean Hockley is refereeing the game. Now, to Bills fans, this probably makes some Bills fans nauseous. I'm on my phone right now, so I can't pull up the exact numbers, but I think off the top of my head, over the last like three seasons, or it may be like since Josh Allen became a Bill, like I said, don't have the exact numbers, but I think it's 40 penalties for 367 yards Sean Hockley and his crew have called against the Buffalo Bills.
Whoa.
I'm going to swipe out. I'm going to break the rules here just to...
Where are you, like, confirm. Finding this tidbit of information?
Yep. 40 penalties for 347 yards.
Wow.
And the Chiefs, on the other hand, are 8-2 when Hockley refs, and 2-0 in the playoffs.
So the fix is in.
They want Taylor on the screens for another week, man. AFC Championship game.
Sounds like
Josh Allen 0-3 against Mahomes in the playoffs. Still can't win the big one.
Sounds like it, man.
I told you that. That makes me think Chiefs. It makes me think Chiefs.
I mean, that's beautiful. And you know what's so beautiful about that? That I'm going to agree with you. I'm going to take Chiefs so it's recorded. But secretly, I'm going to bet on the Buffalo Bills. Because every single time, the opposite yeah, happens. Because literally. It seems so obvious, right, when we record it on Thursday. But then when Sunday rolls around, we're like, what the hell were we thinking? So that's great. So, yeah, Chiefs, definitely. That's interesting, dude. Where the hell did you find that?
I saw it on, like, two Twitter accounts, actually.
Damn. All right.
I verified. All right. Yeah, and I saw like Bills Mafia was like definitely feeling some type of way about it. Yeah, man. I don't know. Chiefs got a good defense. Bills, they got a good defense too. It's a bit banged up. Chiefs, you know, struggling on offense. Bills offense has been electric. They've been running the ball real well though, and that's kind of where the Chiefs struggle. They got Chris Jones clogging up the middle, but outside of that, like, They're towards the bottom of the league, run defense wise. So, I don't know, man. James Cook and Josh Allen could have a day, like, but
my
turnovers.
My only thing that's like, Mahomes looked great in that super cold game against Miami, and Tua obviously looked bad, but like obviously Bills. You know, beat down on my Steelers, but it was a 7-point game there in the fourth quarter. Steelers almost came back a one when they were down 21-0. So, like, even without hearing that officiating thing, I could see an avenue of the Chiefs winning because of Patrick Mahomes and, you know, how big this game is and what he does in big moments. Like, that boy shows up in big moments. And you are the preacher on top of the hill saying Josh Allen doesn't show up in big moments. It's probably the biggest
this
moment.
This is the biggest one. This is the biggest one.
Of his career, really. Because if Bills win, this thing's imploding. You know, Stephon Diggs is posting encrypted stuff on Twitter. He's taking down Bills stuff. He's demanding a trade. Like, you know this team's going to blow up. Coach is probably getting fired. Mike McDermott's probably getting fired. Like, this is a big one. So... yeah, Taylor Swift is probably going to advance another round.
Like that, I didn't touch on Mahomes. I totally agree with you. Bills are a bit, you know, banged up on the back end. I think they got their safeties back, but they got a strong secondary on the flip side. And Allen, you know, he still has that turnover tendency. Even when he beat Miami in Week 18, had two picks, so he avoided the bug against Pittsburgh. Right? He didn't. I don't think he did. He have one.
Yeah, he got one. What? Josh Allen get a touchdown?
No, a pick.
Yeah, no, he didn't throw a pick.
Yeah, I think he did. So he's due. He's due for a pick, bro.
Yeah.
Can you look up if he's gone more than one game without throwing a pick this year?
Oh, God. Yeah, let me
check. I bet he has, but just out of curiosity.
Look at his game log. All right, so... Holy shit, though, he has it.
Yeah, dude, he's throwing one. Lock that in. Yo, let's put that in the parlay. Josh Allen pick.
Dude, that's crazy. Yeah, because he started with 3-0, 1-0, 1-1, 1-1, 1-1, 2-1, 1-1, 0-1, 1-2, and then 0 against.
Dude, he's due.
Dude, that's so funny. That's so hilarious. Yeah, dude. We're going to add – that's one of the lays. I'm adding that right now. That's one of the lays. Josh Allen over 0.5 interception. I hope that's – I don't even know if you can bet on player props yet.
I'm about to say, like, I think DraftKings, you can do, like, particular player. I'm about to say, like, Snead. I feel like Snead gets one. I feel like Snead picks them all.
Dude, that's so funny. That's so awesome, too.
Allen pick, bro. He's so due. It's happening. That's going to be a tight game, man.
Odds are like 105.
Oh, plus? Minus?
No, minus.
Oh, still, dude. That's not bad.
That's like not bad odds.
That's actually solid.
I'm going to add that. Dude, that's a lock. Has it gone all season? Without back-to-back games, though, an interception.
He's doing it, dude. He's doing it. He's going to be like...
It's like how he was due for a rushing touchdown against the Steelers, and he got that. He's due for a pick.
Yeah.
Oh, man, that's great.
Josh Allen pick.
Yeah.
Hey, I mean, like, they've come back from his picks this year at times, so they could do it, but, dude, I don't know. I feel like it's Chiefs.
We might have to put that on the parlay.
I think Chiefs are
plus 120.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Chiefs and Allen pick.
Yeah, that's what I'm gonna do.
I like that, man.
One plus pass interception. It's already plus 290.
Because it's just going to be another year, another freaking Chiefs.
AFC that is like, I'm sending that, dude. I'm going to post that on the Twitter, bro. Lock of the week.
Josh Allen pick. Interception. Let's go.
That is the lock. Let's that is like it. Literally, I know you said you hate the word lock, but that is such a lock.
That's, that is. Or you could do like play of the week or play of the day. Like, Josh Allen pick. Dude, we're posting that. Let's go.
Yeah. Moving on though from this game, unless you had anything else to say.
Nope, that was that's pretty it.
I think the only other good game is in the AFC, the Texans and the Ravens. But my overarching point, I just want to hit on this, just so I'm not blabbering on about nonsense. I want to clobber in the 49ers Packers game with this point. Like, obviously, I think. The outcome is going to be Ravens and 49ers. I don't really see an avenue really of an upset happening because of how these teams play and they're at home. But I will say there is something very dangerous about playing teams like this, and Ravens and 49ers are both playing these teams, that get hot at the right time at the end of the season. They get in the playoffs and they remain hot. I mean, Packers just became the first 7 seed to knock off a 2 seed. And Texans, even though they won their division, they smoked the Browns, and now they're going into Baltimore. I just think, like, these games, and when I look at the opponents of, like, who they have, maybe the Ravens a little bit more of a challenge because Bills and Chiefs. But, like, this game is even more of a test. Because both 49ers and Ravens, they've been resting the past 2 weeks, some even 3 weeks, and they haven't really played a full
skill football, and you got to play against a team that is like on fire. Everything is clicking on all cylinders. So it's going to be a major challenge. I like wouldn't be surprised if the first half, maybe going into the third quarter, these games are close. Looking at the spreads right now, they're both at 9.5. I wouldn't be surprised if I think the team probably mostly that's going to cover is probably the Texans, just because I feel like 49ers, even with their rest, there's just way too much that was going so right for them that I feel like, and how they interchanged injuries and all that stuff, and they had Christian McCaffrey, like they'll be fine. So I think, you know, 49ers will probably cover that game, win by 10, but Ravens might struggle a little bit. What I'm trying to say, though, is that I'm not surprised because of the challenge that that is. And I, some people might find it surprising, feeling little upsets like that, but like Ravens and 49ers, like they, like obviously they're not going to take it as a joke and they shouldn't, but I just wanted to like kind of highlight that point of like, this is like a major challenge, even like more so than, you know, the Chiefs playing the Bills or the Buccaneers playing the Lions. Like those games are going to be harder than a lot of people think.
I like that point. I like that point a lot. And I think I agree with you. Texans, not, that's too many points. Too many points for CJ Stroud. Like, I would expect that to be 5.5. I think that would be a proper – I just do. Mm-hmm. And the Ravens are a team that has a tendency to not blow leads, but, like let teams inch a little bit closer at the end of the game, probably a little bit closer than it should be. And with that time off, like, yeah, and, like, CJ Stroud's just sizzling right now. Same mm-hmm. with Jordan Love. But I have a little bit of more faith in the 49ers too. In San Fran over that Packers team. I mean, Cowboys were due for a collapse. 49ers are a different animal, but the Ravens, especially with how Lamar has said that he's a little bit weary coming off byes in the past.
Yeah.
I love Texans to cover. Yeah, man, Packer 10, I don't know. It feels like 13 maybe, but like I don't know about 10. I don't know. I don't like that. I don't like that.
Yeah. I think I might add the Ravens the cover to this parlay. Or
Ravens no,
Texans the cover.
Yeah, I like that.
Because, like, I mean, 9.5 is a lot. I mean, I just, like you said, I just think this game is going to, like, Texans might have a 3-point lead going into halftime. You know?
Yep, I can see it.
You know, then I'm risking a, then we're risking a strong second half from Texans. But I just think Texans are going to put up a good fight. Ravens, they're 6-3 at home. They're much better on the road, but still, B-more is going to be, going to be popping. They're going to be crazy. And Texans definitely had that home field advantage last week. I don't know. Let me check how they're on the road real quick. Dude,
there were a lot of blowouts last week. I think this week we get close games. I like the Chiefs Bills to be really close. I think the Texans Ravens is close. And I think the Lions Bucks is close too. Packers-Niners, I think, is going to be like a 31-17 type thing. Maybe 24.
You think 49ers are going to cover their 9.5?
I think, but I don't – do I feel confident about it? No, just because how hot the Packers are. And, like, what defense is Joe Barry going to scheme up? That's a great question.
I
don't know.
I don't know. I feel like the Packers are really their strength really comes from their secondary.
Yeah, I was going to say that, yeah.
And Cowboys are all about passing it. Now they're playing against the 49ers that if they're going to pass it, it's going to be short, quick throws like in the Brock Purdy's hands right out. But really they're going to be running the ball. And they're going against the best running back in the league. So that's why like I feel confident that they would cover, but I'm not gonna force anything.
No, I'm like, I don't think all the games are close. I think this one, if there's one that's going to be like a little comfy win, I think it's the Niners at home against the Packers.
And I think McCaffrey scores.
This reminds me a little bit of, like, maybe this is like a stretch of a comparison, but I used to be a Panthers fan. This reminds me a little bit of, like, yeah, I mean, shit, McCaffrey scores. Like, I like that, to put that in there too. But this reminds me when, I guess it's not the same because the 49ers went to Carolina. Anyways, this is just too young of a Packers team to get by a experienced, seasoned 49ers roster with Kyle Shanahan at the helm. Like, this, the 49ers ain't the Cowboys. They're not, like, they ain't the Cowboys. They're not going down.
Yeah.
I think it'll be, dude, yeah, I think it's going to be tough for them to keep it close. I think the Packs run ends, as much as I hate to say it, because I love this Packers team. I'm a big fan of Jordan Love now. But, like,
yeah, I think about it, I think I hate to put guarantees down, but I think 49ers 99.9% are going to win this game.
What's the money line?
Money line for Packers?
Niners.
-450.
Mm. Yeah. We could That's even do, put, do an alt spread or something.
What would you like the alt spread to be?
Like a touchdown, but I like the 9.5. I do. I like the 9.5.
Yeah, I like
the Cowboys. The Niners are not the Cowboys. Like, yeah, they ain't the Cowboys. They're
better coach. They have better talent on all sides of the ball. I just think, like, and no offense to your brother and all the other Packers fans out there, but it's just like, this is a different team. This is like the team that I praise that are in earlier in the season going to the Super Bowl. And I still think that they are. Which, who they'll end up playing, Lions, Buccaneers, that's the last game.
Mm-hmm.
I think Lions win this game.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't feel confident in Baker Mayfield this game. Don't feel confident in him.
Baker's a guy. See, he always, like, he's always, at least he's getting his swagger back. I feel like he's a guy who's going to wake up feeling dangerous, no matter what. It's just, is that going to be 4 touchdowns, 3 touchdowns, or 3 picks, 4 picks? What Baker are you getting? Like, he seems fired up now. He seems like, especially, did you see what CJ Gardner-Johnson had to say?
No.
He, I had the quote written down, but he said something, he said something along the lines of, like, if those guys in Tampa had a good, he said those guys in Tampa had to have a good quarterback. If they had a great quarterback, then they could be great. Basically saying, like, Baker's just good, not great. And then Baker responded, like, that's cute. Like, but he mentioned Russell Gage. So obviously he hasn't been watching much film because Russell isn't with us anymore. So he should get back to that film study and stop talking.
Mm.
And I was like, ooh. Okay, Baker. I'm like, shit, right? He's right. CJ likes to talk. He talks way too much, bro. Talks way too much.
Yeah, it's for sure.
But so there's another little nugget. Like, who is gonna, like, step up their play? Who's all talk? Who's all bark? Who's bite?
This is Lions money line. I mean, are we really entertaining Baker Mayfield winning this game?
Well, that's on. It's basically Baker's on a mission and the Lions are on a mission. So which one do you think stronger? I agree. I think it's the Lions.
Yeah, I think Detroit. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, good for Baker. I mean, I hated that he was on the Browns just because of that division rivalry. I like the resurgence he's having in Tampa Bay. He'll hit the market this offseason and hopefully find himself a home. But it just feels like their little run is dead. It's kind of how I feel about the Packers. It's just there's too much weight on Detroit right now. There's a lot of momentum of just like winning their playoff game and like in the way that they did it against Stafford. Like there's a lot there. I just don't think Baker's gonna bring it. I know he brought it against the Eagles, but like I think a lot of people sort of predicted that a little bit. But we're talking about Dan Campbell, who would go to war for his guys, front lines. He's not going to let that sort of decapitation happen. So, and, you know, respect to Todd Bowles as well. Great coach, Super Bowl winning head coach. But I'm riding with the Lions money line there.
Yeah, I agree. Like I said, I think last week we saw a lot of upsets. This week, things start to fall back into place a little bit. And, things are turned to normal. Like I said, though, I do think the Texans keep that thing close. Too many points for CJ and Co.
So, through our conversations, I build a parlay.
Yeah.
A six-legger. 15 to win 319 plus 2032. The final one, I mean, this is just based off conversation. I don't know if there will be any blowback here. Chiefs money line and Josh Allen to throw an interception.
Mm-hmm.
Christian McCaffrey to score anytime and 49ers to cover.
Mm-hmm.
Texans to cover, 9.5.
Mm-hmm.
And Lions money line.
I love that. I like it, man.
I'm going to lock it in right now. I mean, 319, that's all of our money back and then some. So, for sure, I put that one in. I like it. I mean, that was organic conversation right there. We didn't even try to push anything. I like that. I really like the Josh Allen bet, dude. I think that, like, especially looking at the stats, like, numbers don't lie. Homie literally has thrown a pick. Hasn't thrown a intercept, like, hasn't gone two games without an interception. That's crazy. That's
dude,
crazy
those are
stat.
Great odds, too. Like, that's McCaffrey-level consistency scoring touchdowns that he's throwing picks. Like, you get that at minus 105, dude. I got to slam that straight.
Yeah, dude. Minus 105 is crazy odds, too. I thought, like, Vegas knows everything. Although, you know, maybe they do know everything. Josh Allen has
maybe a little bit of a trap
game.
But, like, nah, dude. Nah.
Nah, he's got to throw one.
I like that. Is that, game Sunday? That game Sunday night. Isn't that the last one?
Yeah, that's the very last game.
Ah, dude, can you imagine? Like, Chiefs are up like two touchdowns. Allen like heaves one to double coverage to Diggs. Like, picked off.
Parlay
that's
hits.
The last one we need.
We're hundredaires. Hundredaires.
Awesome. That'd be awesome. Hell of a way to. I like our reads this week. I think, you said it. That's organic conversation right there. I don't have any notes or anything. It's just I just soak shit up like during the week. I'm like scrolling through Twitter. I wonder how many hours I'm on Twitter a day. I miss the old Twitter though.
Yeah,
but
dude.
I still get my fix.
I updated my phone and I got the X now and I hate it.
Mm-hmm.
Got the X app.
Did
you have the old Twitter app?
Did you can do like the I did the shortcut and like you can change like the app art and like make a
yeah but like it still says X and stuff. I used to have the bird, so like even like when I get up there, like I just
now you can change the name. Like I just look it up. I did it. Like I couldn't.
No, I mean like once I get
at the top. Yeah, yeah,
it's still X. It's still X.
Yeah, I just try to like not look at that. And every time I do, I like want to throw up, but.
Yeah.
So yeah, let's go, baby. That's a nice divisional round zap parlay right there.
Yes, sir.
I like those picks a lot. I might even recycle those into some other plays. But
other plays, yeah.
Yeah, man. Let's go. NFL, it's coming to an end, which is sad, but it's the best time of year. This is when the best of the best like emerge. Jalen said it, like somebody's gotta win. It ain't us. Not our time, not our turn. I'm like, man, shut up. Like, man. Could have been your turn. Could have been your fucking turn. should have been.
New Drew Walsh video just dropped.
Yeah. Dude, did you see the Bleacher Report meme that they are like photoshopped?
That was so great. Whoever intern made that, that was awesome. Yeah.
That was some so type awesome. Of shit that we would make.
Oh, yeah. I'd be gobbling over that.
Classic.
That was definitely made like Monday. And the game was like, you know, that like it was definitely made the Monday before. Whenever it was announced, 100%. That dude was on it. He's like, yeah, I got this. I'm saving this for the vault. A-plus, like, we gotta get this. Yeah, so A+ memes there.
A+. Let's end on just a little bit of hoops chatter. I think we're approaching an hour. Nice little hour show. But as literally the day after, I feel like something always happens after we hang up the show. Whether it's like a buzzer beater or like I think Sabrina hit one time, Jokic hit one time. I'm like, something always happens. Like right after, or like I wake up the next morning, I'm like, shit, we could have talked about this last night.
Yeah. I'm scrolling on Twitter and I'm sending you. I'm like, dude, you got to be kidding me. Like, I wish I would have saw
it. I know. Hey, it just be like that. That's how fast the sports cycle moves. So it just be like that sometimes. But I think it was literally the morning after, Wednesday morning. I woke up to Shams, Woj, the whole NBA Twitterverse going crazy. Pascal Siakam was indeed dealt to the Indiana Pacers.
Boom.
It's a bomb. Big time bomb. What was I forget the
basically exact you have it down. Basically Bruce Brown and 3 first round picks.
Bruce Brown.
And then like the Pelicans sent some dude over because they tried to get under the tax. But it's basically Bruce Brown and 3 first round picks. Biggest main player available in the trade market is out as we approach basically the heart of the trade NBA season this next month. All I got to say is, what a beautiful fit for Pascal Siakam. Going to a team that is historically, so far, the most efficient and really the best offense the NBA has ever seen. Check the stats on there. Check the box scores. Check everything. They are one of the efficient, best offense in the NBA, entirety of NBA. They space the floor. They got shooters. They move fast. Siakam's going to fit perfectly in there. He loves the cut to the basket. Loves to move around. He's stretched. He can shoot. It's going to be so great for Indiana Pacers. A lot more fun. They definitely, put their chips in and said, we're going for a title this year. Will it make them title contenders per se? I don't know. I don't think so. They'll be a very fun team to watch. They'll be a team you don't want to play in the playoffs. They'll definitely make the playoffs, but I don't know. I don't know if this really puts them over the Celtics hump, the Bucks hump, the Miami Heat hump. I think it puts them kind of like where the Sixers are, where I think maybe a little bit above the Sixers, but basically like, yeah, we're going to make the playoffs. Yeah, we can win a series or two, but I don't see them lasting long enough to win it all. But I still think it's a beautiful, beautiful fit. Siakam's still going to test free agency, but I don't know. He might be easily persuaded with a point guard like Hallie and a center like Miles. So I don't know. What were your thoughts on it?
Yeah, he says he wants to get a deal done. So.
Oh, okay.
A lot of times it doesn't happen, so I can't say that. But they'll definitely try. I think it's a great fit. He's a guy who's not a complete zero on defense. And like you said, he's got a bag. Wish he would. He can score at all three levels. Nice mid-range. You know, he's going to be a great sort of pick-and-pop guy for Haliburton. You said a guy who can cut to the basket, you know, find open space, just fits in so perfectly. And then guy who's not a zero on defense, like you can man that low block with Turner, kick out, guard some of the wings, big time wing help for that Pacers team that desperately needed it. But I agree. It doesn't make them like They're a lock to make the playoffs, but they might, if they get a favorable first round matchup, they might win that. But do I see them beating the Celtics in a series? No. The Bucks, no. Even the Sixers, no. The Heat, no. So I'm right with you.
Yeah, I think it's right there with the Sixers. I have no disrespect either. Like, it, you know, I still wouldn't want to play against Joel Embiid in a playoff series. You know, it's still like
second
scary.
Round. Like,
yeah, it's still
second
scary.
Round, yeah, not shit.
But yeah, I mean, it's definitely interesting, and we'll see or whatever. But on the flip side, Toronto, not a bad haul. OG leaves. And Pascal leaves, but you bring in RJ Barrett, Emmanuel Quickley, Bruce Brown, and a slew. I forget how many picks New York sent, but I would assume they're playing around with four or five first-round picks. Mm-hmm. Granted, they're not the best picks in the world, but they're still first-round picks that you could couple and, you know, ship out, whatever. Yeah. So definitely stuff to work with. They're definitely embracing the Scottie Barnes era, which – I mean, they should. He's been balling recently, despite all the trades. I mean, he just yossed up my Heat last night. Yeah. Thank you very much. That was came out of nowhere, but still, like, I still think, like, for especially after they just let God, who did they just let walk in free agency? Regardless. Rex. Just instead of letting Pascal walk for nothing, Fred VanVleet. That's what I'm thinking of. Yeah. Fred VanVleet. Like they didn't trade. They decided not to trade him, and then he left in free agency. They got him for nothing when they could have got something for him. And when you look, you know, they could have got nothing. They could have prayed that they would have re-signed or not, but they probably wouldn't have, even though, you know, they're saying all the right things, saying that they want to. They could have left with nothing, and they got a nice haul. I will say, for those players.
Yeah, I agree. I definitely agree. I don't think Bruce Brown's a fit there, though. I think they could flip him. They just got too many. They got like Chris Boucher. They got Jonte Porter. They got RJ. I just don't think he's just.
Yeah, they do have a lot.
His services could be utilized elsewhere. Definitely could be utilized better elsewhere. But
yeah. Agreed. But, you know, you could get him and package all those picks or whatever. I don't know. Definitely. Figure something out. So.
Yeah, I would love him on the Sixers. I would love me some Bruce Brown. We'll see.
Yeah. But, yeah, that's, I think, overall kind of win-win. We'll see how the Pacers go. Hallie's still not bad because that hamstring injury. Like I said, those injuries are scary. They're the worst. You never know really with those things.
They're tough.
But yeah, I mean, that's really, and I'm, again, the two teams we said before the season even started that we're waiting for, Toronto Raptors, what they do with OG and Pascal. We figured out with them. The next team we're waiting on is the Chicago Bulls. It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. Where's Zach LaVine going to go? Where's Caruso going to go? Where's DeRozan going to go? Where's Vooch going to go? Who's going to stay? They have to figure out. They can't just ride out this team and expect to, you know, you're not winning a playoff series with that team and how they're playing right now. They're just not.
Yeah, definitely not. They just played tonight. They beat the Raptors tonight. Raps are on a back-to-back, though, because, as you said, they just whooped them
last night. They used up everything. Got new players and everything. Good Chicago, you should win that game. And Miami, you should have won that game as well. But
Exactly. Yeah, I agree. Chicago is probably the next one to implode. It's only a matter of time. Trade deadline's coming up. NBA is getting juicy. It's as the NFL starts to fizzle down a little bit, fizzle out. But we gonna have it all right here on the Zap Show. Hopefully for episode 33. My favorite number. We got a nice little six-legger for divisional round week. Hopefully this is the one. Hopefully this one hits, bro.
Hopefully this
33,
one hits.
It should be. Like, if it doesn't, I might have to pick a new favorite number.
I just can't wait till we get to the NBA lays.
Oh yeah, that'll be fun.
The NBA ladies will be fun. Nice.
That'll be fun.
But yeah. March Madness too.
Oh yeah, we'll have to do our brackets on here.
Oh yeah, we'll have to. Yeah, maybe we'll. If any fans will join, we'll do a bracket challenge.
Oh, a pool. Yeah. That'd be sick. I would love that.
Hell yeah.
It's that time of year, man. It's that time of year. On that time of year.
If the winner isn't one of us, they can hop on a show with us for a segment.
That would be sick.
Talk NCAA ball or something. I don't know. Figure something out.
Yeah. That's an option. Or it can, you know.
That's just popped in my head. We'll see.
Give you like a gift card or something.
Yeah, we'll see.
Nah. But yeah, we'll figure it out. We're going to be here regardless, whether it's on a phone, whether it's on a laptop, whether it's in a hotel, whether it's at one house, two house, three house. Like, we're going to be here.
We'll be here, baby.
We'll be here.
We'll be here.
Giving it to you live. Well, not live, but it's live for us. But
I will say in advance, Tuesday show gonna have a music segment because in 9 minutes it is midnight. And the boy LD, Lil Dicky, Dave Bird is dropping a long anticipated really album music finally. It's basically the mastered version of his soundtrack of Dave throughout the three seasons, but there's some heaters on there. There's some tear jerkers on there. And there's some good songs. So we'll definitely be reviewing that for any LD lovers. But I know Zach and I are hyped about that. So a little precursor for next episode.
I've been waiting for this for years, brother. Years.
The thing is, though, I don't know if I'm going to listen in order because, like, I know the songs. I want to, like, listen to.
Yeah.
The first one I'm probably going to listen to is probably That's a Joke because I know that's going to be an immediate, like, song playlist.
Slapper.
And then I don't know. I'll go from there. Jail, I just want to, like, see the music video. I don't even want to, like, the song's probably going to be, like, 15 minutes long.
That's the thing. We need music videos for all. That's like the album's the first part of the experience. Then he's coming with the music video.
Yeah, because That's a Joke music video comes out tomorrow. And I would assume, I mean, he's got 22 songs. He'd probably stretch it out for like, he could do like an 11-week thing of like two music videos a week if he wanted to. But
I'm sure he's been filming them, man. Dude's a workhorse.
He's been on a TV set for the past like 4 or 5 years.
Oh, yeah.
For sure.
He's got so much. I know. I'm so confident that he's got a lot in his bag, up his sleeve. Not just this album. I think he's got a lot more coming. Dude, I feel like he's got a song with Drake in it.
Dude, he said no features.
In the vault. Well, not this one, but he said the way he phrased it, like he like affirmed that there was going to be more, like with features. At least that's how I took it.
Okay, all right.
That's how I took it.
But yeah, he definitely got a Drake song or two in the vault for sure. Got a couple Drake verses he's just sitting on.
I know. He's just waiting for the right time. This man's all about timing. And dude, yeah. I feel like hopefully this is a good sign for good things to come in the future. It's for you, for me, it's for the world, man. The world needs some pick-me-ups.
We need good vibes.
Big time. No better place to look, man. No better guy to look at than LD, man.
The industry.
Oh, it's going to kill me. That's going to kill me. I need to look it up. Or look it up.
That's a joke. Ha, 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 ha. That's a joke.
Dude put on his Heath Ledger.
Yeah, he did. He went Joker on him. Yeah, let me get the video out. The music industry.
Industry standard shatter. I think.
Bang.
No, was that it? I think that was it.
Oh, you want...
See what the guy, the first mofo says.
is what we have been waiting for. The new industry standards.
The new industry standards.
Yep, you got it. Love it. You got it.
Yeah, if you haven't peeped that, shameless plug here for LD.
For LD, a.k.a. the independent variable.
A.k.a. Mr. Leftward Slope and Jesus. You caught all day.
You would go all day with them shits, dog.
A.k.a. Oh, the original pancake.
We going out tonight.
A.k.a. Oh, man. Yeah, it was... Dude, he's got him. He's got... I could rip him.
He's
rip him
man.
Off for days here.
He's the man. But yeah, 5 minutes.
5 minutes.
Penis.
So, this is going to be the penis. The penis of existence right here. Just a genius album name. Like, come on. Like, Zenith. Penis.
Penis.
It's classic, bro.
Bye. Come on now. Give it to me, boy. Give it to me, boy.
All right. Hey, we're getting too excited. It's almost midnight, bro.
Yeah, bro.
Till next time.
Peace.